strange if people ask you to tell something about the history of a particular field. You get the feeling that you are already retired and that you can stop working and you should not talk about new stuff anymore. But thank you very much, Anna, for inviting me. So a day like this makes me actually very proud that like people are Anna and Christian, they were among the brightest students that I've ever been able to work with, and I'm very proud that they are able to organize, let's say, a day like this with so many people, and also building products that people love to use, that actually deliver answers to interesting questions. So this is the year where I'm, I think for 25 years, employed by this university. I did not work on process mining all the time. That started about, let's say, 15 years ago, or a bit shorter. And I would like to give an overview of process mining. Today, already we spoke a bit about the magic of process mining, so I don't have to explain you that it's about discovering patterns, discovering processes, discovering how people work, etc. We've seen plenty of examples of that. So this is the expedition that I would like to undertake. So I would like to position the field. I would look at trying to find out where did process mining really start, and that's actually a very difficult question. Then a bit closer in the past, what are the kind of tools that have developed, what have been the type of trends that have been done. I will also try to explain you why process discovery particularly is a very difficult task with many challenges, and there is still a lot of research to be done. And that will be kind of my plan for today. So let's first position it briefly with respect to data mining and business process modeling or business process management. So this is a picture that I often use these days. So what you can see, let's say, on the vertical axis is that process mining is bringing together business process management or business process analysis and data mining. So these are two completely separated fields. There are whole conferences, there are vendors, there are courses on business process management, where people just stare at models. At best, they try to implement these models in actual systems, but it is not driven by data at all. On the other hand, there are many people working on data mining. They are driven by data, not so much by models, but the models that they look at are typically very simple. They typically look at one particular decision in a process rather than end-to-end processes. Process mining is bringing these two worlds together. It's a very obvious idea, and it's surprising that not much more people are actually working on this at this point in time. It's also surprising that there are not much more vendors providing software to be able to do these types of things. And it's probably because customers are still not capable of asking for the right software. Because this is a very obvious thing to do. Process mining can be used to answer compliance-related questions, and it can answer performance-related questions. And you can do these things by joining data and processes. That's the only reason why you can answer these types of things in a satisfactory way. So people have been using simulation for decades. In simulation, you're not using actual data. You're using a model, but you're not using data. So the results may have very little to do with reality. So this is showing that it is kind of in between business process management and data mining. I'll let me briefly give a bit of an overview of these two fields. The business process management field emerged from the workflow management area, and before it was called office automation. And what is, if we are talking about the historic context, the people that you see here were already in the late 70s working on PetriNet-like models to model business processes and subsequently implement them in information systems. And so many things are not as new as they may seem today. People were working on that at a very, let's say, conceptual thing, but they were probably too early in many different respects. Here you can see kind of the tree of business process management. So it emerged from the workflow management field. The workflow management field emerged from the office automation field, but you can see that the topic has become broader and broader. Workflow management was mainly aimed at implementing systems. Business process management is much broader, also looking at, let's say, process improvement, business process redesign, continuous improvement, and all of these types of things. So that's the BBM field. If you look at data mining, it's a bit more difficult to pinpoint, let's say, where that area started. Of course, there have been statistical techniques available for centuries. They have been applied in very different ways. You can kind of guess a bit how long that exists. And when data mining emerged, the statisticians were very angry at people doing this. They were using terms like data dredging, data phishing, data snooping, because they were not using it in the real statistical valid way. If you do it in the real statistical perfect way, you can never draw a conclusion. So data mining people were trying to make these types of things practical. In the 1950s, the area of artificial intelligence emerged, and there the idea was to build machines that were thinking like humans. A more down-to-earth field, but very much related, is the field of machine learning, where you try to do a particular task using sometimes human-like learning capabilities to do a very particular task. So for example, like playing chess. So this is the computer that can beat the best chess player in the world for the first time. There have been many of such devices later, but that was a result of machine learning. So you are learning to do something from data, basically. There are many other names for the field, and these are kind of the ingredients for data mining. If you look at the data mining field at a very high level, there are basically two tasks. One task is supervised learning, and supervised learning means that you have a set of rows, and today we have seen many slides showing tables with rows. We are looking at rows, and there is one column that you would like to explain in terms of the other columns. So, for example, you want to know when you die, and you have the different habits that you have in life, smoking, drinking, eating, and all kinds of other things. And you want to predict how long you're going to live. That is a typical supervised learning problem. So you can use decision trees, regression, etc. So just to sketch it, I'm not going to explain this, but this is a typical decision tree that you could make, for example, for our students. You collect the grades that students have for all the individual courses, and you try to predict whether at the end people will pass or not. And you predict that based on various variables. And so if people fail at logic, they will fail their whole curriculum. That's what you can see in this. The opposite of supervised learning is unsupervised learning. And you are not looking at a particular variable, but you are trying to find somehow a pattern in data that is unclassified. And so techniques like clustering and pattern discovery are typical examples of that. I think some people in the audience know, for example, the notion of association rules. There you try to find out, for example, by looking at lots of bills in a cafe, for example, you're trying to learn the rule that people that order tea and a cafe latte typically also order a muffin. That could be a pattern that you discover, and it's unsupervised. I didn't say that I was looking at who is eating muffins. It's just a pattern that emerges with a certain confidence. So that as association rules, they don't look at the order. There have been techniques in the data mining field that look at patterns where the order matters. I think one of the more interesting approaches that is seldomly talked about is mining for episodes. So an episode is like, if you look at this graph E1, this picture means that in a particular time window, A, B, C, and D happen. B happens after A, C happens after A, B is followed by D, C is followed by D, eventually, within this time window. And you try to find rules that if one episode occurs, then typically also another episode occurs. So you can see it is already a bit in the direction of processes, but not end-to-end processes. You just look at local patterns. If this or this happens, then in the same time window, typically this happens. So just that you get a bit of overview of work that has been done. So that is the relationship about data mining and business process management. But when did process mining start? I did not really answer the question yet. So based on my analysis, one of the starting points that you could see is in 1967. I was 1 year old at that time. I was trying to learn the Dutch language. I never got really good at it, but then Mark Gold wrote a paper, and if you read the paper now, it looks a bit like a novel type of thing, but it was really a mathematical paper with the mathematics hidden behind a thick philosophical layer. And in that paper, he looks at the following situation. A mother is talking to a perfect child and is giving sentences. And the child has to guess after each sentence what is now the Dutch language. And so what are all the rules of the Dutch language? So the child could just kind of reproduce all the strings that it hears and says this is the language, but the child also needs to generalize. Otherwise, each time the mother speaks a new language, the child needs to revise the hypothesis of what perfect Dutch is. So a perfect child is able to learn the language after a while. So we say that a language is learnable in the limit if such a child exists. It's a very, let's say, philosophical kind of description, but I will link it to process mining in a minute. So he defined this notion of learnable in the limit, whether a child can learn the language by just seeing examples. Well, one of the most of the results in this paper are of a negative kind. For many different languages, such a child does not exist. So, for example, if you look at the class of regular expressions, so for example, here I say A is followed by zero or more B's, which are followed by C or D. That's an example of a regular expression. Even a simple language like the regular expressions cannot be learned in the limit by this perfect child. It also turns out that that you can think of very many different variations of this problem. And one of the things that is crucial is that if you just feed positive examples, learning a language is much more difficult than if the child is able to generate a sentence and then the mother says, this is not a correct sentence. If you have the latter, you can learn much more. Unfortunately, in process mining, we typically have positive examples. So many of these results here are applicable. So he also indicated frequency matters, and in later work you can see various things. So the relationship to process mining, I think it's quite obvious. So a sentence in natural language corresponds to a trace in an event log. It's just an example that you see. The process model corresponds to the language. You try to discover what the language is by only seeing a set of examples. So that's the relationship between these two problems. In that same time, there were many people looking at this in a theoretical sense. Don't read all this, but basically it is shown that if you have a regular language, then there is one unique minimal finite automaton, say the mother of all process models, and it was shown that such a model exists, but you cannot learn it over finitely many examples. So you need a mechanism to generalize somehow. So there were people like Biermann and Feldman that developed techniques that just look at the last couple of events that have happened and then just have a finite amount of steps that they look back and then learn such an automaton. Now you may say, why is this all relevant? Many of the initial mining algorithms were basically using the algorithm that you see here at the bottom. So many of the process mining tools, you can still see these IDs back. And you have to look at the time. This is a long time ago. The approaches that I mentioned before, they don't look at probabilities. They just look, is something possible according to a model or not? Of course, in processes, frequencies are incredibly important. Some paths are more likely than other paths. So there are these general results, and I'm not going to explain you, but it's nice to see the time window in which people have been working on these things. So there is the problem given a model with probabilities of going from one state to another state. What is the most likely path, if you see an observed trace, what is the most likely path through the model? The second problem is giving a set of traces. Some traces happen very frequently, other traces happen very rare. What is the most likely model? There are algorithms, and so the bottom algorithm is extremely expensive, to try to learn something like this in a stochastic way. Here you take into account probabilities, but you look at a really low-level model, and not a model that you would like to look at. So I still didn't answer when did it really start. So we have lots of we have seen the years in the top. I briefly mentioned this pattern mining by Agrawal in the mid-90s, where a lot of work was done on that. There is the paper of 1998 by Jonathan Cook and Alexander Wolf. They were discovering process models in the context of software engineering using very much the techniques that I've been explaining before, but put it into that field and show pictures of models that you actually would like to discover. Then there were some other approaches that you can see at the bottom, but you have to see that around the late 90s, there grew an interest in discovering end-to-end process models from a business-like perspective. And that's what you can see. But all of these approaches, they had lots of issues. And so almost all of these approaches, they don't consider concurrency. So you're looking at a sequential process where things cannot happen in parallel. Many of them were unable to handle noise. So if one exception happens, that will kind of destroy your model. You cannot reason without it. They were looking at local patterns rather than end-to-end processes, or the models are just pictures without any formal semantics. But you can see that in the late 90s, let's say, this field emerged. So here at this university, the starting point was 1999. Then I wrote a paper with this title, and it was based on a project proposal that I made together with Tom Leiters. I was moving from one department to another department, and we had to find the topic in between PetriNet and workflow management. That I was working on at that point in time, and machine learning, where Tom Leiters was working on. So we thought, what would be a good combination of these two worlds? Well, you've seen my initial slides, combining data mining with business process management, and then this choice is pretty obvious to work in this field. So we did. That led to several initial, these three initial PhD students that did seminal work in this area. So for example, Anna Kuijla worked on genetic mining algorithms. Boudewijn van Dongen, for example, worked on implementing the alpha algorithm. You can find it today, for example, in the PROM tool. But also several other discovery algorithms that were discovered at that point in time. So that is clear starting point, 99, when it started here. But that's something that I can be clear about. Here you can see some of the people that are that were involved in these first years. Over time, many, many people have worked on the topic, so I do not even try to mention all of them. So I apologize for all the people that I'm forgetting. So what are the main process mining developments in this century? So starting from the year 2000, what has happened? So it started off, so one of the first, I think probably now the most cited article is the article of the alpha algorithm. We didn't talk about process mining, we talked about workflow mining. And that had to do with my background. I was very much interested in workflow technology. And I had this vision, I saw all these companies that had rooms filled with people modeling funny diagrams. And I thought this can be done much better. We just extract the data, we learn the model, we put it into a workflow system and we are done. We don't need to have these 50 people to document all these processes. Well, that was of course an incredibly stupid idea in hindsight. So the basic vision was that if this is the normal life cycle in which you build the models, the basic vision was, okay, let's skip the design phase, we just learn what has happened, we configure the system, and we are done. Of course, it doesn't work like that. But actually, you still see today people talking about workflow mining, having this as a mindset, which I think is very, with all the knowledge that we have now, I think it's not, not a very smart idea. In my view, and this picture tries to reflect that a bit, data, models, and systems, they coexist in a very complicated way. It's not that you can derive one from the other. They all have their own value, and it's, you need to think about how they relate to each other in a very sophisticated manner. So these were the early days. We were having this vision of workflow mining, finding a control flow model, and that was a very narrow view on process mining as we know it today. Over the years it broadened a bit, so this is a picture that we started probably using around 2007, perhaps already a bit earlier. Initially all the efforts were done on discovery, particularly of control flow, but we started to broaden that in all kinds of areas. So for example, Anne came from Potsdam to Eindhoven, and she started to work on the problem of conformance checking. So given a model and an event log, where do these model and these event log disagree with one another? And it was a real extension of the process mining field, and I regret that today people that are not very much into this topic, they still see process mining is the same as process discovery. Well, the field is much broader. To provide value, you need to look at it in a much broader way. So we started to extend it in the area of conformance checking. We also started to enhance models. If you look at DISCO today, you can see that it is showing where the bottlenecks are. You are replaying the log on top of the model and extending the model with performance information. And that's its lower arrow. Initially it was just control flow, but for example, Min-Suk Song, he worked here as a PhD first and later as a postdoc, who for example looked at the behavior of people in a process mining setting. So social network analysis, but also the discovery, what are the roles in a company? So if you just look at the event logs, I do not know the organizational structure, but let's try to discover what the organizational structure is. And it shows that it is an extension in beyond control flow to also look at other things. So our view started to broaden. This is a nice picture taken in November 2007. Let me highlight the two most important people today. And so this was the team that was working at that point in time on process mining here in Eindhoven. So you can see that it also has grown in size a bit. So if we look at process mining today, we have kind of moved on, and we are now, the pictures get more and more complicated because we are considering more and more different types of process mining. So people often see discovery, finding the elephant trails, the desire lines, or discovery. I'd been spotted by several people of when I was walking out of the building that I took a shortcut here. So if you go outside this, take a look at it. And I think several people told me that I was doing that what was happening at the bottom. So it's kind of funny to see that this metaphor sticks to people. That, it's a very clear way of explaining what process mining is. So at a very high level, it's discovery and conformance checking, seeing where people deviate, seeing what people do. But as this complicated diagram is showing, and I'm not going to explain it in detail, it's very important to see that it's not just control flow, it's also modeling resources, modeling human behavior. It's also about data. If you have a decision in your process model, you need to know what is driving that decision. If you see a deviation, you want to see what do the cases have in common that deviate. It's not just control flow. It's also not just at design time, looking at historic data. I think the process mining field will also move more and more to kind of real-time process mining and also doing predictions. And so it is not that useful to say that sometimes somebody did something very stupid 1 year ago. You probably want to say you're about to going to do something extremely stupid. And so. So this means that this field is more maturing and that it becomes broader and broader in terms of the functionality that we would like to support. So these are the developments. Without talking about a specific tool, it's interesting to look at tooling in such a historic talk, because tools are of course very important. If I write 1 million papers, you do not care. Only if there are tools that are kind of based on powerful ideas that do something, only then it becomes relevant for you. So this is a picture from 2002. As you can see, some people are here in the room. We all looked a bit younger at that point in time. This was a picture that we made at that point in time based on a meeting of several people making process mining-like tools. So we try to agree on a common input format. So it looked like a very long time ago. It's only 10 years ago. And it's amazing to see how many different things have happened. So you can see that there were different individual tools supporting one algorithm. So for example, the AMID tool was supporting the alpha algorithm. And as bonus, it was also showing how much time was spent in particular states. The heuristic, the little thumb was comparable to the heuristic minor plugin that we have today. It was just one particular algorithm. So it was stupid to kind of work with, each time you have a new type of analysis, to work with a different tool. So we tried to unify these efforts. So here you see some screenshots from, let's say, that time. This is a tool. The MIMO, that was the first tool that kind of implemented the alpha algorithm, and I cannot program, I'm live at programming, so I implemented in terms of a PetriNet machine that was actually doing this analysis for me. But of course that was not the way to go. We decided to build upon a common shared platform with a pluggable architecture. So that started in 2004. And the idea was that each time people would come up with a new type of analysis, it would be added and everybody in the whole world could use it. That was the basic idea. So here you see a timeline of the different releases from 2004 until now. And I'm not going to explain all the developments, but I just highlight some of the versions. So version 1.1 contained 29 plugins. And here you can see three of them, one to discover a social network, one to discover an EPC diagram, one implementing the alpha algorithm. So it was a tool with a limited scope. Then in 2006, we had versions like PROM4, and then we have 142 plugins. So already 142 different types of analysis that you could support. And then the range extended to also have conformance checking, performance analysis, and other types of things. Well, this development continued a bit, so it kind of ended with POM 5.2. And in POM 5.2, there were 274 plugins. As you can see a screenshot at the top. And then it became a bit unmanageable, and that we had made some initial design errors, and we thought we should kind of restart from scratch. So from POM 5 to POM 6, everything was re-implemented from scratch. So one of the important ideas was that in POM 6 there is also a package structure that allows scientists or other developers all over the world to build their own functionality, that other people can use it without us in Eindhoven doing anything. So it's a real distributed a type of approach where everybody can contribute in whatever way they want. It started with less functionality than what we have ended with 5.2, but also this has been growing over the years. Now it's a bit difficult with all these packages to count how big PROM is at this point in time, but if you include everything, all the packages that exist, you have like almost 700 plugins that exist today. So 700 different types of analysis. This makes it incredibly difficult for people to use. Yeah, so it's incredibly powerful. It's like a Swiss Army knife this size, with all kinds of, with 600 different tools that you can use. But for some people, of course, this is a bit overwhelming. But it's a very nice platform for people to start getting into this field and also to contribute with new ideas. The idea of, let's say, commercial tools is to pick the best ideas and to try support these best ideas. And today we have this in lots of examples how easy it is once you have the data to use process mining tools like Disco. You've seen these things live. It's really easy. The scope is much narrower than PROM, but it's much easier to use. I think that is how these things are positioned with one another. So let me say a few words why process discovery is so difficult. As I've been telling you a bit about tooling, development, etc., etc. But one thing that you don't realize, you see these pictures and in 1 second there is a process model, but there are still many challenges, and I would like to explain to you why these challenges exist. Well, making a process model is like keeping a plane in the air, and you have different forces that you need to fight with. It is incredibly easy to make a simple model. I just remove everything that has a low frequency, and if you remove them off, you get a simple model. But there is a force between having a simple model and having a model accurate. And accuracy, you can view that from three different angles, like, is it able to explain the behavior that we have seen? Is it not overfitting? Is it not underfitting? And so perhaps I should devote a minute to that. If we would build a decision tree in this room, and we would like to predict our address, where every one of you lives, and we would take as input, I don't know, your birth date, the city where you were born, or something like that, we could build a decision tree that would perfectly predict for everybody in this room kind of which street they live. If I ask a person outside of this room and I apply this decision tree, it would not give me any meaningful results. So that is the challenge in process mining. You're just seeing examples, and based on these examples, you need to infer a model. And so we have seen several examples today where you have, of all the traces, most of them are unique. So you need to generalize, but you need not to generalize too much, because otherwise you're saying that anything is possible. So that is a delicate balance there. So the problem, if you look at it at a more high level, is that there is a real process, but the problem is you don't know it. You don't know the real process. The only thing that you see is you see examples. One of the the ways that I often try to explain that, suppose that we are sitting here with 365 people in this room. What is the probability that everybody has a different birth date? It's a very simple computation, but you get a huge number, one divided by a huge number, and that huge number is the same as the number of atoms in the universe. So the probability that everybody of such a group of people has a different birth date is the same as throwing a dart at a particular atom in the entire universe. So that probability is zero. So if you're looking at event logs, you have to realize that you're only seeing example behavior. If you see 365 traces, if you have a model that allows for 365 different traces, the probability that you will see all of them is close to zero. Because of the reasoning that I just explained to you. So you need to generalize, you only have examples, and there are various techniques to do that, but that makes it very, very difficult. You also don't have negative examples. And the mother is telling to the child, you should not use that sentence, that is not correct. In process mind, we never have that, unless there are people annotating traces. Models also need to be an abstraction. I think Anne mentioned that briefly, and I will come back to that later. I call it the Murphy's Law of process mining. Everything can happen, just wait long enough. So making a model that is ready for any situation is not interesting, because it's the model that says anything can happen. So you need to abstract, you need to have an interest in the 80-20 model or something like that, to do something meaningful. So to cut a long story short, we are looking for a sheep with five legs, and we are working on that. So some key observations which surprisingly, not that surprisingly, which related very much to the things that Anna was saying in the morning. I would like to mention, and they kind of show, let's say, how our thinking about process mining has evolved since the time we spoke about workflow mining. So one thing that has not been emphasized today, but I would like to emphasize now, alignments are essential. So this blue line is the process model, discovered or made by hand. Now we look at reality, and the real process deviates from the modeled or discovered behavior. We would like to understand why this deviation is there. And that means that I need to relate observed behavior to modeled behavior. I also have this situation of behavior that is close to the model, but doesn't fit completely. If I want to use the model for analysis, for performance analysis, I need to squeeze this green line into this blue line. Otherwise, I cannot use my model. And that is where we are using the notion of alignments. I will not explain it in detail, but every trace that you see in reality, you try to relate that to a path in your model. And you need to be able to do that, and you need to see where it doesn't fit, and how severe these problems are. Today, several times, people were talking about auditing. This is the key of auditing. Understanding why people do something different from what is planned. So that is essential, and not something that we thought about in the beginning. Models, you can think of models as glasses to look at data. If you just look at raw data, you don't see anything. If you look at them through the right model, you can actually see certain patterns that you would otherwise not see, certain insights. And so models are just like a lens. And there is not a single model, there may be multiple models. This morning, I think Anne showed several slides of Dennis Wood of this particular area. When I made these slides, I was in Moscow. But just to illustrate very much the same point, is this is a map of Moscow. Is this the perfect description of Moscow? Is this the only possible map of Moscow? Of course not. Depending on what we do, we want to use different maps. So we can zoom in if we are interested in a particular area. It looks trivial if I show it to you, but now look at all the people that are making process models with hierarchy. There is a fixed decomposition, and it is impossible to seamlessly zoom in and out. You need to have some completely different capabilities. You may look at the same area, but visualize different things, like for example, what is the vegetation at a particular point in time. If you take the subway in Moscow, you need to have a different map. If you're taking the bicycle or the boat, you need to have a different map of Moscow to use it. So one reality, many different maps. Which map you use depends on what you would like to do. I can visualize things on top of these maps. The easiest metaphor is the metaphor of traffic jams. So here the things that are in red are indicating on a Monday morning in Moscow where the traffic jams are. Earlier I was talking about real-time process mining. You would like to have such a picture of what is happening in your organization now. Not what was happening 1 year ago, but what is happening now. And then everybody will look at these models. So I'm almost to the end. I would like to briefly mention some for us main research challenges and then come to a conclusion. So one of the challenges for us is still finding the sheep with five legs. So this one has five. I think the previous one had even seven legs if you looked carefully. But we are happy to find one with five. And we are getting closer and closer to actually doing that. There is the challenge of dealing with big data. If your goal is basically to just draw a picture to give an overview of the process modeling of the process, things are very scalable. Things are extremely fast. But if you want to make more precise models that have a predictive value, you need to have much more computation power. And also the data sets are getting bigger and bigger and bigger. So for example, we had a visitor from China that brought, a couple of months of one of the biggest Chinese search engine data with her. Yeah, then every of the algorithms that we know today just crash, because then you are not even able to load it into the system. There are several challenges in this area. In particular, we are working on distributing process mining problems. So taking a big problem and decomposing it, lots of smaller problems that can be solved much easier. We are interested in on-the-fly process mining. So that is if you have the situation where you have to deal with streaming data, where you cannot store all the data, it's just streaming data, but still you want to have models that kind of evolve with the data stream that you're analyzing. It is related to, for example, also the topic of operational support, to predict what is going to happen. So we have techniques that given a particular case that is in a particular state, we predict what is the remaining processing time. We predict, will this case deviate in the future? Give certain probabilities. And so these things are difficult, and that's why we like them. Another problem is concept drift. It's like process mining is sometimes like trying to score a goal, but people are moving the goal while you are trying to shoot at it. Concept drift is the notion that your process is changing over time. We had earlier the talk about Suncorp. I spent each year 1 month in Brisbane, and when I'm in Brisbane, either Brisbane is flooded or parts of the country are on fire. You have to imagine for an insurance company what that means. If there is like a peaceful situation, there's no work to do. If half of the country is on fire, then suddenly your processes are different than in other situations. So concept drift, the fact that processes are changing when you're looking at them is an important problem. Another issue that I think in one of the questions that they asked this morning is we are interested in cross-organizational or comparative process mining. One of the nice examples is the COSELOC project that we are doing with 10 municipalities. all the Dutch municipalities, in principle, they execute the same processes. So at every municipality, you can ask for a building permit. It is handled in a particular way. Yet, different municipalities are doing it in different ways. They are not competing, but they would like to learn from each other. So one is doing it in one way, the other is doing it in a different way. So it becomes interesting not to discover one process model, but to look at all these different processes and try to understand when is something going better than in other situations. I think in many larger organizations, like for example Suncorp with multiple brands, there are interesting questions there. Or if you have large companies that have like a distributed SAP installation, etc., you have a common ground to compare things. Then there is a problem of context-aware process mining. One of the nice anecdotes is that we were analyzing the logs for Rico, that is selling copiers. Copiers fail when the weather is changing. So you have to think, what should you put in your event log to discover these types of things? If you put all the different characteristics in there, you will have an unsolvable problem. I think it's very important to see what do you put into your process mining problem as possible causes, and then to do process mining. That you don't overlook a very important point. And then the question is, we need to have a methodology and techniques to do that in the proper way. The last point is, we would like to support the process of process mining. Today we saw some people that are very handy with executing a sequence of steps to do a particular analysis. But of course you would like to save such a workflow. They are repeated each time you want to do it. Yeah. It's an interesting topic, how to do that. It's also related to distributing process mining problems. It's an interesting topic. So to come to a conclusion, we have a bright future. So we are all sitting here, we are all enthusiastic about process mining. Moore is doing his work for us. So every 2 years, everything will double. So if you compare the situation now with 10 years ago, it is incomparable. In 10 years from now, we will have so much data that we cannot imagine at this point in time. And process mining, linking data and processes will be one of the key technologies to use for that. So for example, it doesn't stop. Here you see, for example, in yellow, the prediction of that in the next 10 years, storage capacity will multiply by 50. The 10 years after that, it will again multiply by 50. So that gives an idea of what can be done. Of course, the challenge also for many people here in the audience is to turn all this data into real value. We think that process mining is an important ingredient for that. And we also feel that for our education, something like this is important. Because, like you can see the title of this article, Data Scientist, the Sexiest Job of the 21st Century. I think that's an indicator of things to come. People that can deal with large amounts of data, use them to add value, will have job security for many years to come. I would like to thank you very much for your attention.